for the family. Thank you for making it a very special day for a very, very special person. My younger brother, Mel, some calls him Jimmy. As most of you know, my brother has been ill for several years. I remember coming home back in 2015. I'm a missionary to Indonesia, so we get to go home every 4 years. And he was really sick, but his heart was no longer functioning well. And he needed a miracle, and God gave him that. It cost somebody's life. A 23-year-old, I think, biker died, and he was a super match for Mel. And Mel was given several more years to live. That's why I think God loved Mel very much. A few years ago, Mel had a bad heart. By the grace of God, he was provided with a heart that gave him another 6 years to live. One of many times God intervened in Mel's life, he was given an extension of more days with us here on earth. I gotta tell you, standing here looking at you guys, we got old, some of us, right? And it's never easy. The first time I did this, Mel knew a friend of ours named Willis. He died young. And I was his best man, and I was also spoke at his funeral. Then a few years ago, my mom, so it's not easy. My knees are quaking as we speak. I really hope as I talk here that Mel will come out behind those walls and say, "Hey folks, what do you guys want to eat?" Well, as the years pass, his kidneys, and when that got worse, we knew that was, the heart was strong, the second heart. But when his kidneys was getting bad, it was just getting worse, and he needed dialysis. Years passed, and I gotta thank God for my sister Joyce, who not only took care of my mom, but took care of Mel. And she did a wonderful job. But I wrote this, they told me to write something. No matter how much time we have to prepare for this day, and we knew it was going to come, we still don't feel ready to say goodbye. There are some people who's going to stand here and say goodbye, but including me, but they're not ready, and I'm not ready to say goodbye to them. We are not here for a heavy heart. I need to remind us that this is a celebration of Mel's life. We could have a long face, we could cry, but this is a celebration of Mel, Jimmy, who loved everybody, loved people that he just met, and want to keep that friendship and don't want to let it go. So we are here to celebrate his life. So we are here together as his family and friends and celebrate his life like he wants it to be. So remember that. I'm gonna read as we go to the word of part of the program. I showed now this part of the Bible in Ecclesiastes, some mouthful for some folks. It's written by Solomon, who was the son of David and Bathsheba. If you know a little bit about the Bible, this to his main character in the book of and the historical books. And Solomon writes this, and when Mel heard this, he said, "Hey, is this, did somebody make a song out of this?"
We are all given time. I'm 61.
There's 4 years behind me that is in front of me. My brothers and sisters could also attest to that. Jeremy is only in his 50s, but some of us are getting to the 60s pretty fast. Some of the younger people here, there's more days ahead of you than that time. We also know, as I reminded you that we have a beginning and the end. Life has an end, and the end is death. There's four seasons that we go through every year that cuts our year into a quarter. And it makes our year go pretty fast. I mean, who's to think that in no time here in the Philippines, Christmas is celebrated with a month, a chance with birth. So September is already Christmas in the Philippines. And we look at our life and we cut it in quarters, and we know it's Christmas and other years has passed. So I just want to talk to you about the time. Time Mel has given us is so precious. He is the first of the 8 siblings of the Abrahams who's gone ahead. And we're surely going to miss him. But let me just share to you the Bible verses that I told Mel to look into. The time, or the little time that he had. And he knew it. He knew when I last spoke to him last, he said, I hate where I am now. I hate this. He just got sick. Well, maybe some of these verses you guys heard already. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. The word there is believe. Told Mel, I'll give you these keys right here. That means it's yours. And he says, no, because you haven't given it to me. I said, here. Here's the keys. So he takes it. And I told him, is it yours? And he said, yeah. And I said, no, it's not. Because you haven't received it. A lot of us know and believe in God and Jesus, but we haven't received Him as our Savior. And this is what this verse is talking about. Some people, because they have so much sin, that they don't think they're good enough for God. Well, the Bible says that, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then, the wages, like if you work somewhere, you get wage. The wages of sin is death. Not necessarily right away, but I was diagnosed with Parkinson's 4 years ago, and I keep asking, how did I get this? Some people say it's the chemicals that you put inside you, and I was just doing no good. Why Mel's life was shortened than ours? Well, he had a lot of things that he was doing that we told him to stop doing. And if that causes us a short life, it's proven. Just ask the doctor. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. There's a choice for all of us. Whether we die without God or die with God. Mel often tells me, Kuya, he calls me Kuya, just come to my room and I'll show you what I've been doing. And that's why I don't think God is going to accept me. I've just been doing some bad things. It's just the other side of now. Well, we. Well, it's just another fun. It says in Romans 5:8, it's how much God loves us. But God shows love for us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So no matter, how bad you are, Christ still died for you. And in Romans 10:9-10, I said, well, listen, here it is. And he kept telling me, when I'm ready, I will accept him. And I'm opening my heart that he did. I asked that to Joy, what was he talking about in these last days? He said he watched a lot of messages from the TV. Romans 10:9-10, I told Mel, Mel, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe your heart that God raised him from the dead, you are saved. For when the heart believes and justifies, the mouth one confesses. And the Bible says you will be saved. Saved from eternal damnation. Spending eternity with Christ. Then I said, I got out of Romans and I told him, two more. Ephesians 2:8-9, for by grace you have been saved through faith. It's not of your works. It's nothing that we could do to earn eternal life with God. So we could boast. It's not that. It's only by grace. Grace is receiving something that we don't deserve. That's what grace is. We deserve a lot worse. But God's grace has saved us through faith. And in 1 Corinthians, I told him, here's the last. I spent so much time with him. I don't know if you've been in Keswick, the colony of men in New Jersey. You spend a year there. It's not a jail facility. It's a place where men could get out of their bad business. Men who did drugs and they were up there and income, they were businessmen, these guys working in hand, and they just hit the wrong spot and they go in there. And I told Mel, this is where I think you could spend time and take a time out. And we'll come and visit you. We got him in. But as soon as I came home in the Philippines, he said, I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. And the last verse, 1 Corinthians chapter 15:3-4. For I delivered to you the first importance and also received that Christ died for our sin according to the scriptures, that he was buried and he was raised again on the third day according to the scriptures. That's what I believe, guys. And that's what I told now.
to know about this.
Then we will sing a song. Can anybody sing here? Because I cannot hear. Rob.
Easy?
Oh, wow.
Come on, Rob. In death, resurrection. before we sing the hymn, I'm going to ask Joyce.
Today, my brother, we have been proud to see you all. We have been in this way. First of all, I want to say thank you for coming here on a special day. Mel did not want a funeral. He wanted everyone to remember him in a happy way. He loved music, listening to the 70s songs. He told me he wanted me to play disco. It's beautiful. And I laughed. And he said he wants people to remember him happy. I want to share something with you after working for 30 years until I got sick. I did not know what I wanted to do with the rest of my life. I did not know if I should go back to work immediately again. It was my father who talked to me and said, you need to do something else that would require a lot of your health. I did not know what that meant. And I was just thinking and wondering what it was. When a year or two passed, I realized what the message was. My mother got sick, where she needed me to care for her. Then my brother Matt got sick 2-3 years after my mother, and then my sister Grace. That message was clear. The purpose of my life is to take care of the family in serious needs. Yes, I took the responsibility to care for all of them, and it was my blessing that I was chosen to care for them. I know deep inside they were very thankful. So yes, I continued to help my mom, and I became a second mother to my brother. Now, until the final days. Mel was first diagnosed with heart disease back in 2011. He had a quadruple bypass and subsequently a heart transplant. My brother was taking two kinds of rejection medication for his heart. One of the medication ruined his kidney and he needed to be in dialysis. Mel has moved from White Plains to Poughkeepsie and lived with me for 2 or 3 years after his transplant. Eventually, Mel felt better and got stronger, and he decided to live on his own. He was incredibly happy and worked part-time as a pizza maker. He had his days when he felt good and was able to do things like catering, which was one of his passions. Mel loves to cook. As most of you remember, he loved to celebrate his birthday by cooking and having block parties at our place in White Plains. He did that for years. He liked to get together. He liked to get everyone together. Mel also enjoyed being with his siblings. Family gathering was one of the best things that he ever tell you and wish it never ends. Sometimes after gatherings, he will call me and start reminiscing how we grew up. He will talk about when his nieces and nephews were very young, how they made him laugh. He misses everyone, and when he was over, he told me that he would like to have more family gathering. It really doesn't take much for a brother to be happy. He loved his daughter, Alex. He would call her often in a day, just to tell her, I love you, Mama. Then my brother needed help with Alex. I became Alex's second mother. I started taking care of Alex when she was a baby. Mel will call me often to tell me, call your daughter. She's looking for you. He was so proud of Alex. The last family gathering we had was last Christmas. I can still hear Mel play playing Unos with my siblings. He has so much fun. Every time he spends time with my sibling, he's so happy. It's like music to his heart. He didn't want to go home. He was disappointed. It was time for him to leave. Also that night, I was upset because he couldn't sleep overnight just to be with his family. Although Mel was sad, he knew he needed to go back home because he needed to take his medications. After family gathering, he took Mel weeks to recover and be back being himself again. He would constantly call me because he didn't want to be alone. He got depressed, not seeing everyone daily, but he knew everyone needed to go back. Mel was a fighter. He was in and out of the hospital, but he knew that he would come back home every time. His cardiologist doctor said that he has an extraordinary strong heart. At this time, Mel needed more help physically. He couldn't care for himself anymore and was extremely limited for what he could do. When Mel met Barbara, his nurse's aide, over 5 years ago, he had passion for caring for Mel. Barbara was taking care of Mel, helping him walk, cleaning the apartment, laundry, shopping, and medication, and even staying with him during dialysis. Sometimes they acted like husband and wife. They had their moments of arguing and picking on one another, but she stayed and took care of Mel until the end. I just want to say thank you, Barbara, for your time and patience.
It was my pleasure.
In caring for my brother, it was a lot for my
family. He was my best friend.
My brother is also funny. He always made people laugh every time. He tells jokes, and his laugh was so contagious. As the year passed, Mel's health deteriorated. He got weaker, sicker, and was constantly in and out of the hospital. During his last year, he was in the hospital a lot often because of the water in his lungs. The pain was so severe that he would just call me in the middle of the night telling me that he wants to go to the hospital. This has become more routine for him as Mel continues to fight. I became Mel's healthcare proxy. I remember when he needed x-ray, MRI, or any test, he would always tell me, don't forget to tell them to resuscitate me. So I said, Mel, they're only taking a picture of your heart. Mel gets very worried, and he was very afraid of dying. The last 6 months was extremely hard. Mel was often in and out of the hospital about 4 or 5 times a month. Mel was getting sicker and sicker. The doctor had discussed him needing a liver, but was too weak to get a liver transplant. That's what he wanted. He was in a lot of pain increasingly. I remember the last time I spoke to Mel, he was in the hospital. It sounded great. He was complaining about food, of course, no. And asked me to make him some Filipino food. However, after talking to him the night before, in the middle of the night, the doctor had called me and said that he started having seizures, and they needed to put a tube in his throat. Mel was hospitalized for weeks. He finally got moved to a hospital in New Jersey. Once he got transferred to New Jersey Hospital, he went into cardiac arrest. I remember his doctor had called me and my siblings to have a family meeting. We kept on telling the doctor that he wanted to be resuscitated, but I knew my brother wouldn't want to fight anymore. I couldn't see him suffering. He was tired. When the doctor told us that she knows what we want, then she asked us, what does Mel want? Then we realized that he had enough. Looking at him suffering was the worst thing to bear. It was time for us to let that go. I had told God that he needed to be with my mom and dad, and that they're waiting for him. It was the hardest thing for me to do. He was in the hospital for 2 months until his death. As my brother mentioned before, in the New Testament of the Bible, John chapter 3, verse 16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The one thing that I know is even though man is gone, he will never be forgotten. He will live in our hearts and in our minds. His memories will always be with us forever. Thank you.
So we'll sing one more hymn, and then we will end with the eulogy and the benediction. What a friend we have in Jesus. Everyone else is real. We are never alone in our grief. God is with us. And he promises to help us through this difficult time. So seek him. Our prayers can offer comfort and support as we mourn our loss of my brother Mel. If you are looking for strength during this difficult time, turn to God's word and prayer. They will be there for you. So let's pray. Almighty God and eternal Father, for whose love in Christ we cannot be parted, either by death or life, hear our prayers and thanks for the gifts for all whom we remember this day. Enjoy in them the purpose of your love and bring us all with them to your eternal joy, but only through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This is, as we close, the eulogy. And I'm going to ask my eldest sister to go first. Okay? And anybody who's his friend who wants to say something, this is the time. You can stand there, we'll bring you the microphone.
Your spirit. We know that no matter what, you will always be with us. When life separates us, we know it is only your soul saying goodbye to your body. But your spirit will always be with us. When we see a bird chirping on a nearby branch, we will know that it is you singing to us. When the butterfly brushes gently by us so freely, we will know that it is you assuring us you are free from pain. When the gentle fragrances of the flower catches our attention, we will know that it is you reminding us to appreciate the simple things in life. When the sun shining through the window awakens us, we will feel the warmth of your love. When we hear the rain pitter-patter against the windowsill, we will hear your words of wisdom, and we'll remember you told us that without rain, trees cannot grow. Without rain, flowers cannot bloom. Without life's challenges, we cannot grow strong. When we look out to sea, we will think of your endless love for your family. When we think of mountains, your majesty and magnificence, we will think of your courage. No matter where we are, your spirit will always be beside us. For we know that no matter what, you will always be with us.
Thank you, Lynn. I have something to say about now. I asked Dee and my other brother Jeremy, but they said, you just go and write something about Mel. My brother Mel was never disrespectful. Yeah, you might have seen him say something to somebody, but as far as the family, he always, even our, because when we call each other Kuya, when we're young, that's okay, but sometimes it just disappears when we get older. But he always respected me as the older brother, Kuya Dave. It's term to give respect to the elder. It might sound weird to you guys, but it shows respect. Mel and I never liked winter, the cold. We tried cold skiing with the rest of our brothers and sisters, but we didn't like the winter. In 35 years, we kept saying, oh no, another winter. I remember one Saturday night, my dad, if any of you know, he's a very strict, disciplined man, military man, and he owns the house that we lived in, so he said, Mom, you guys are coming home, be home a certain time. Well, one night, Saturday night, Mel and I came home around 2 o'clock in the morning, and the door was locked. And Mel and I looked at each other, and it's 10 degrees outside, and we hate winter. And we looked at the car, and we knew that's where we were going to sleep that night. So we hate winter. And Mel would say, man, it's cold. Yeah. I said, yeah, it's freezing too. And when we slept in the car, I caught him one time turning it off because he doesn't like the heat either. So he said, it's too hot. I said, no, it's freezing outside. And so we're on and off, an hour we'll fall asleep, he'll turn it off, and I'll turn it on. And that was one of many nights that we slept in the car together. My brother Mel never wanted nothing else but you and him to be friends. Even if just passing by, I always told him that he could talk with Ed, I think, because he just had that personality. And once you're friends with him, he doesn't want to let it go. He'll invite you to his house, we will have a family dinner, and he will bring somebody. And I said, who's this, Mel? And somebody he wants to eat. So let's eat with him. So he loves people. Mel loves to cook, as Joe said. Italian dishes is his best. When his health is not good, he gathers enough strength to cook me. When I'm home, linguine with white clam sauce. He does it so well. Mel knows his family cares for him. As you all know, he had a prolonged sickness, as we mentioned before. But he loved us. He loved us because he knows he's about to leave us. And like last year, the wedding of Andrew and Nancy, it was a struggle to leave him because he wanted to go. But the flight could not take him. The long drive cannot make it. So he said, go. And have fun. And we did, without that. That's what I remember about my brother. Anyone who wants to say something? Thank you.
well in September of 1982. We shared seventh period typing class. He sat behind me. I was new to White Plains. Every day, every single day, he tapped me on the back of my shoulder and asked me if I had a piece of blank paper so we could prepare for the typing drill. I really think that was his way of getting to know the new girl on the block, but every day. We've been friends ever since. I love him like a brother. He is my brother. I miss him. My family loves him. He was kind, he was funny, he was very caring. We loved to go out and eat. We called ourselves the original Calorie Crew because Sundays and Mondays we alternated between Chinese food and Colombian food. He loved his 70s music, as it was said, his disco music. He loved certain movies. He would call me to tell me certain movies were on. Jaws, Godfather, his absolute favorite was The Sound of Music. He hit the roof and hung up on me so fast, and that was when I told him it was on. He's like, I gotta go. And click. I miss my friend. I really, really miss my friend. But I am grateful that I had 40 plus years of that kind of a friendship where we share joys, we share tears, immense laughter, lots and lots of shenanigans. A chapter, a season in my life, a very big season in my life, I realized that he was part of my life story. And now I begin writing a new chapter without my friend, but sharing memories that I will continue to have until I meet him again in glory.
Thank you, everyone, for sharing this with us and inviting us. We appreciate that. Jim was a coming character. You mentioned John the hard time. We were at the hospital account the day before we had a question. Me and Sophie, and some of you mentioned, we actually took a little banquet over to him. We took some food over to him. And we sat there and we had
all the whole spread.
The wings, everything, just everything. Soup to nuts, and we had a blast. The next day he comes, hey Bosh! Yo, get my heart, man, I'll see you tomorrow. Great, I'll see you tomorrow. And that's what we did. We saw him next day. And me and Sophie were kind of following around from hospital to hospital. I know Bush knows this. And this is going to be a real hard right now. Because he is my brother, and I love that kid. Last time we saw him, he was in the hospital in the kitchen. And he had a trach. He couldn't speak to us. But he had tears in his eyes when he walked in the door. And he said everything he had to say without a single word in his sentence. And that was the last time that I saw him. And I thank the Lord for allowing me to go out there and meet with him just a few minutes. And Sophie actually got lucky. With Calder on FaceTime, and she got to say goodbye to him, which I'm very jealous about, to be honest with you. But I'm glad that she got to say goodbye, because she got to say goodbye for all of us. And I truly love that brother of yours. He meant everything to us. So thank you for sharing this with us.
Born in 1967, raised primarily in New York since And in that time, I had run away from home, been involved in all kinds of trauma in my life. And I was fortunate enough to have God grace me with Jim's friendship and just give me a place to live when I needed it. A little story about myself, my testimony is that I am blessed to be a child of God, unified by the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I was in Florida in 2006, I was baptized as a walk. And in that time, I was fortunate enough that God gave me the privilege to keep the country that long, especially when he ended up becoming compromised in his house so much that he needed a hug. And along with another good friend of his, Juan Ortega, and also based in Florida, we both had the privilege to come visit Farewell a few times during his time away from Shore Park. We had the privilege to, you know, obviously keep in touch with him. And that was a blessing in more ways than one. I would like to just first pray for us all, because it matters to me, but I would like to share something with you. So, you went with me, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for the privileges to come before you, provided by the redemptive work of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for the privilege to be together with us, family and friends. We thank you for the privilege to bear witness to the saving knowledge and grace of Christ in our good friend. Vision in his life, and just the pleasure of knowing him, Lord, which we know is through your Spirit that was within him. I know that, Lord, that you would truly accept him into your kingdom, and I have no doubt, as the Scriptures tell us, that his word does not return void, and the Scriptures teach us that it is faith in the gospel that brings us to the saving knowledge of grace and the redemption that he gives for our sins. So I believe in that faith and that trust that he is now in paradise with you, Lord, and that we can see him again. And I lift this all up to you in yourself, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'd like to share the fact that me and Jim have a lot in common in many ways, good and bad. And I struggled with many things that I know he struggled with. And when I was fortunate enough that God got through me, I was privileged to share the gospel with him, because that is something that commanded me in my faith, and it is the depth by which God calls his children. And I'm thankful that I had the privilege to share the gospel with Jeremiah, but I did not know until I stood here watching it. What they did, that he was so brought up in the faith. He never shared that with me, never explained that to me. And I guess, you know, God's timing is perfect. I would never have been able to receive it. When I remember earlier, it would have never meant anything to me because it wasn't my time yet. So it is a great joy that I have to hear and witness all that you shared together. So thank you for that. It's funny because when I saw Joel last, it was when he was in the hospital. And when I was on the intern coming up here from Florida, although I've been back from Florida this August or September, 9 years ago, returned in 2014, I left in 98, lived here for 16 and a half years, and I was primarily my dad's caregiver until he passed away in 2012. Jeremiah and me kept in touch only on my phone, and I regret the fact that I never actually got to see him in the 9 years I have been back, not that I recall. I might have, but I don't recall that I saw him personally, but I spoke to him only weeks before he passed. And I just want to say that there's something that Pastor John will agree with me on. You know, he cited scripture that was writing for understanding that Christ died for us. And he also recited a part of Colossians that is really just, in a nutshell, the gospel, understanding who Christ was, you know, that he is the Son of God, that he was born in that, that he lived a righteous life, and that he suffered and died for the sin that we all deserve to die for because of God's righteous judgment. These are things that all of us, no matter who we are rebellious to and war against. God clearly defines this in Scripture. The flesh, which is us, wars against the Spirit of God. That's just the way it is. But God, in His grace, Pastor John was saying, which is the unmerited favor of God, something you cannot earn, something you cannot be good enough for, it is the free gift of God. And that's why it's called grace. He gives it to us and he demonstrates this to that to us. And the fact that he gave us a way to be redeemed, a way to avoid the righteous wrath of God upon sin. And that is in itself the greatest example of love, that he would send his son into this world to be humbled, to live a life as a human being. He is the creator of all things. He is the beginning, he is the end. And none of us can even imagine what it's like to have to humble ourselves to that extent. We never could. And that right there is the greatest example of love. He would make a way for us now because we could never be good enough to be righteous and be worthy of heaven. He made a way for us. And the only requirement in that is faith. He said it in Ephesians, John, you are saved by grace through faith, not of works. It's not about what you do. It's not about being good enough. It's just simply believing in who Christ is, what he's done, and being willing enough to accept that and to be able to choose to decide to, as the song says, submit. It's not about perfection. It's not about, you know, what you can do, but simply submitting to God's Spirit that he grants us for those who believe. We live in a world where we think we always have to do something, or we have to accomplish something in our own power. But that's private, because it's a matter of us always thinking we have to be in control. And that's not what God teaches us. God teaches us that he gives us everything. He gives us the He illuminates our eyes to the truth. No one comes to God by their own volition. He, in his timing, the scriptures teach us that he opens our eyes to the truth. And it is at that point in time that we have only two things we need to do. Have faith, believe, and repent. And repentance is simply turning away. It's not about being perfect. It's not about meeting some type of standard other than God's standard. But again, the grace is in the fact that gives us his spirit at that moment, and it's through the submission to that spirit that is to lead us to do what is right. And when we do that, we make a concerted effort to do that, it's how God changes our heart. So he makes our want-tos become his want-tos, and it's a matter of his timing. It's not a race. We don't compare ourselves to others. It's simply God's timing. And we put our faith in that and trust that he will do his work and finish it until the day of redemption, as Scripture tells us. So, I come from a life where, I'll tell you, I have four families. I have a horrid lifestyle and relationship with families, and with many friends that are ex-friends. But I have peace and joy in nothing in this world could ever give me, never did. I have plenty of money. I've worked and done so many things in this life that most people would think is so grand and amazing, but it really isn't. Because our life here, as Scripture tells us, is just a whisper, a vapor, a moment in time. And that we are intended to live eternally, forever, but in one or two places. And that is either heaven or hell. So I would encourage you to just make as much of this time, not for just your love and remembrance to general, but to the Spirit of God that was quite evident in his life. Scripture tells us when the spirit, fruits of the spirit, joy, peace, love, compassion. I have never probably known anyone that has been more loving, caring, and compassionate than Jim. Every time I've ever been in the home, every time I've ever been with us, even to the family, always welcome, always loving, always, you know, just embrace me, and I saw him do that with others consistently. And that is a testimony to God's grace in his life. So I'm thankful that I've been with us today. And there's my cue to get off. But bless you and thank you for your time.
Okay, just a funny joke that Jemuel always called me. I am the bruja, which means the witch. So, anything's going wrong, you can blame it on me. Let's go eat.
Okay, we're gonna eat soon. His ashes I will take with me to Indonesia first, and then I have a meeting in Philippines in November, and that's where we will bury him with mommy and in the Philippines. And I know he's gonna complain because it's so hot in the Philippines. But before we close for benediction, this is the song that I'm gonna ask Rob to sing. When I heard it, and we'll close with this, when I heard it, I thought of Mel. Mel already passed away. And I kind of reworded some of the, come on, Rob. Some of the words. And you might have heard this. It's one of the contestants from American Idol. And I'm going to hold the microphone for Rob.
Never sang this before, but Dave asked me, I think you can do this. I said, okay. So the guy, he said, well, this is for Mel. So I didn't think anything for Mel. We used to hang out in my younger days. And so I said, I'll try it. So here we go. Never did it before. Well, don't be scared.
Oh,